Hello, today we're going to take a deep dive into William Byrd's motet masterpiece, Ave Verum Corpus. Let's start with a little history. William Byrd lived through some pretty turbulent times. His home country of England flip-flopped from Catholic to Protestant and back again several times, depending on who was in charge. And in most cases, if you happened to be a Catholic when a Protestant king or queen was on the throne, or vice versa, you were in trouble. That made things pretty tricky for a church composer like Byrd, because Catholics and Protestants back then liked their music very different. Catholics were into Latin and were okay with longer, more flowery religious stuff, drawing on prayers and poems and hymns. Meanwhile, Protestants believed everything should be in English, so, you know, people could understand it, and they tended to go for shorter, simpler texts like Bible verses. Byrd was a curious case because at the height of his powers, he worked for Queen Elizabeth. She was 100% Protestant, and like I said, when the Queen's Protestant, everyone else had better be too, at least officially. But there's the thing, in his heart, Byrd was almost certainly a Catholic. So that meant that by day, Byrd was writing breezy English language anthems for the Queen's churches, while by night he was writing intense Latin motets like this Ave Verum that could only ever have been sung in private, out of the public eye. And it's not like this was a secret. Amazingly, we have records of people being arrested for owning a copy of one of Byrd's Catholic masses, while Byrd himself continued to compose this stuff somehow untouched by the authorities. The interesting question is how on earth he got away with it. There are various theories. My favourite is that he was just too good a composer to throw in jail. I mean, he would probably have gone down in history as England's greatest choral composer of all time if it wasn't for the fact that another one came along a century or two later. I guess when you've got someone like that writing for you, I can see why you might like to overlook certain minor details of his private life, like his religion. And so that brings us to Byrd's Ave Verum. You can't get much more Catholic than this piece. The text is an ancient prayer written in Latin, probably by a pope. It's a short motet. It's meant to be sung during communion when the bread and wine are given out. The text is about the physical body of Jesus, represented by the communion bread, and how he died for our sins. So this is a serious, devout piece on a very intense and actually quite personal theme. And you can hear that devotion running through it. You can hear it in every line of the music, in Byrd's careful treatment of the words, in the musical emphasis given to key points in the prayer. You know, there was a time when historians weren't sure if Byrd was really a Catholic or not. But with the benefit of hindsight, if you ask me, of course he was. You only have to listen to a piece like this and you can hear that he really believed what he was writing about. Okay, that's enough background. Let's talk about how that translates into practicalities. As always, when you decide how to teach a piece for the first time, you have to figure out how you will introduce the singers to the piece. The way you approach it, the way their very first experience goes, will have far more impact on the final performance than any details you try to tweak afterwards. So you can save yourself a lot of grief by thinking about this in advance. With this piece, I think the number one thing we've got to think about is bar lines. Now, bar lines as we know them today are pretty much a modern invention that Byrd wouldn't really recognize. And you can tell this from his music. To see what I mean, listen to a tiny snippet from the third phrase of the piece, Cuius glottis perforatum, and think about the musical sense of the rhythm. Get it? It's like a triple feel, right? Cuius latus perforatum. Now look at how different modern editions notate the music. The most common is to add clumsy editorial bar lines, dividing the piece artificially into 4-4. Some scores do this, but then they add editorial brackets showing the phrasing. And then here are two more possibilities, more unusual. You might have no bar lines at all, much more like Byrd would have written it. Or you might have irregularly spaced bar lines to guide the singers on the feel of the music. Listen to the clip again and see which one of these makes the most sense to you. Now, you may not have the luxury of choosing which edition to use with your choir. But if you are stuck with the clumsiest editorial version, well, at least you have to think about how to overcome this barrier. And it is a barrier, because this is not a metric piece. And if your singers approach it like it is, they'll end up singing it note by note and making no sense of the phrasing. Or rather, it is a metric piece, but its natural meter is constantly evolving phrase by phrase, and sometimes different parts have different natural meters simultaneously. Of course, that's all very well, but you don't want your singers worrying about all this detail. You want them to just get used to feeling the meter of each word or phrase. And by the way, that's why I don't like this method of notating it, which adds extra brackets or phrase marks to show the natural meter. It's well-intentioned, but it ends up giving singers so much to think about, it undermines the flow. It's more like an annotated study score. So how do you approach this with singers? Well, one approach would be to give them a little mini-lecture about natural meter and bar lines and so on, like I've just done, and then start them at bar one. My experience is that this kind of thing doesn't really work very well. Anyone who knows the piece already will kind of zone out during the lecture and then sing what they were always going to sing anyway, and everyone else will just find it a bit bewildering. Instead, I think I would start the rehearsal by picking a passage to work on, one where the natural meter is fairly uniform and easy to hear. Cuius latus, which we've just been talking about, is a good one. Esto nobis, a bit later, is another. So you ask the choir to sing this passage and listen to the sound. And then if you're using an edition with clumsy modern bar lines, you point out how different the natural meter sounds from what's written, and in fact how much more simple it sounds than it looks. You can even get them to exaggerate the natural meter, like it's almost a waltz. The alto line is the clearest for this here, because it has four triple meter, as it were, bars in a row. Cuius latus per foratum. Then, the next step is to find a passage where there are multiple different meters simultaneously. I would use the Miserere Mei section, since it's very intuitively expressive. You could sing each line separately, asking everyone to sing everything, of course, so they don't get too bored, and really work on the shape of the phrases in the evolving natural meter, and thinking about where the strong syllables are. By the way, at no point would I tell them where the strong beats are. With polyphonic music like this, I think singers need to get into the habit of feeling it out for themselves line by line. So let them listen, let them sing, and let them feel it out. Then you can layer the parts without losing that rhythmic sense. And only now do you go from the top and you encourage singers to apply their own musicality. You could even give them the challenge of doing it unconducted at first, encouraging them to listen and think about their own lines and not just trust you for the phrasing. Anyway, if your choir is anything like mine, they aren't that great at looking up very much when they're sight reading. Okay, what do you need to think about in terms of accuracy? Well, this piece is pretty singable mostly. There are no really awkward moments. Byrd knew how to write for voices. You will know how much your choir needs to learn by ear and how much work you need to do on teaching them the notes. But even for sight readers, there's a few moments to watch out for. First, the music slips chromatically very freely. Byrd really likes doing this. He loves to give one part an F sharp, then another part an F natural a moment later. The same with B flat, B natural. The notes aren't usually difficult to pitch, but they can be a challenge to tune well until singers get used to the idiom of the sound. For instance, this note for the basses needs to be nice and centered after the soprano F sharp. And this bass B flat follows the alto B natural. But to be honest, since all the chords are fairly regular, major or minor, the best way to fix any problems here is by slowing down and getting singers to listen and tune any problem chords by ear, rather than worrying about individual pitches. There's also a lovely simultaneous false relation here, with an F sharp sounding momentarily against an F natural. A bit of angsty word painting as the sinner pleads for mercy. Have a listen. Yeah, I don't think it's particularly tricky, I just like to point it out. And it comes four times, always on the same word. All right, then there's plenty of opportunity for interval blindness to set in. This alto line may need a bit of attention. And while basses are more used to these kinds of leaps, of course, you may still want to check this bass line. I find my basses like to default to a perfect cadence, so here, C to F, whenever they can, if they're not paying attention. So, you've got the notes and the phrasing sorted. What kinds of details do you need to pay attention to in later rehearsals? Here's some things to listen out for. You won't need to work on more than a few of them, I expect, but keep an ear out and be ready to draw attention to anything that's a problem. Firstly, the bass B flat on De of De Maria needs not to stick out. Octave leaps up for the basses are often a source of embarrassment. I call it the Zadok effect. Especially if you have a lot of low basses rather than baritones, because then this can be a gear change for them. So it helps to make them listen to the vowel, eh. Making people listen to the vowel is often a good way to distract them from doing badly whatever it is you don't want them to do badly. And to be aware that the stress is natum de Maria and not natum de. Then there's the tenor line on Pro Homine. Byrd obviously wants tenors to come through here, that's why he writes them so high. Fair enough, but Byrd's writing does the work for you. The tenors don't have to spike the note too, so keep it gentle. Tenors always like to spike things anyway, given half the chance. Another place where the tenors will of course come sailing through is in the passage with O Jesu Fili. This one is particularly noticeable because they're echoing the altos, who've just done the same thing on the same notes, probably much more smoothly because it's lower in their register. By the way, Byrd wrote this piece for four male voices originally, so both these lines would have been sung by tenors, meaning much less risk of a clash of timbre. Anyway, just ask your tenors to be aware of it and control it. They have three beats rest just beforehand to breathe and to shape what's to come. Tenors, again, don't be fussy on fluxit sanguine. There's a tendency, I think, to be a bit spitty here. Too many sounds in a short space of time. Also, I think tenors tend to see a dotted rhythm and get overexcited. You could even just sing flussit if need be. And finally, think about how you want to do the amen. With a dynamic swell through the dissonance between the altos, tenors and basses? Yeah, for sure. But how much? Dramatic or very subtle? Whatever you do, don't let the basses stomp all over it with these ascending quavers. And then what to say about the miserere? This is a gorgeous, gorgeous sequence. The way Byrd passes the baton from voice to voice. These fleeting false relations. It's beautiful stuff and really hard to mess up. One thing though, the phrasing of the word miserere. Don't let them emphasize miserere just because it's got a higher note. Build the shape smoothly through. Miserere. And especially work to keep that dotted rhythm silky smooth. And yes, I know the basses want to lean heavily on this scrunchy false relation, but they shouldn't. Byrd is subtler than that. Okay, vowels in Latin. You probably know the drill for your own choir. Different groups have different needs depending on, I guess, where they're from and what accent they have. Most English-speaking choirs struggle to stamp out their diphthongs, to say examine rather than examine and all that kind of thing. American choirs sometimes need to work on the nice rich R in parsum, and younger British singers, especially girls, often need to work on a dark oo with a low tongue instead of oo. In particular, the very prominent words cuius latus are an important place to match the vowels because it's such a sudden and intense moment in the music. And then when it comes to performance, what are the final added ingredients that will make this piece shine? Well, for the singers, it's really working on the intense, magical moments. Let Byrd's devoutness come through, especially in the shapes of the phrases. And you don't need dynamics written in the score. If your editor has added them, well, it kind of gives you a harder job because instead of naturally feeling the ebb and flow, your singers are going to be trying to follow someone else's written instructions. If you don't believe me, listen to the Miserere Mei passage one more time. So good. And Byrd builds the tension so effectively with the longer phrases, a thicker texture, more frequent entries, more dissonance. You know, how would it help if an editor had also written piano and forte and so on? It wouldn't. Anyway, my point is the main way for the singers to make the magic happen on the night is to get inside the music and go with the flow. For the conductor, I want to say less arms, more face. Especially cultivate your fake awe and wonder eyes to inspire people at key moments. Also take long, slow breaths throughout the long, slow phrases to help singers carry the piece along. Oh, and of course, just as they don't sing the whole thing in 4-4, you don't conduct in 4-4. You have to conduct the natural meter, the phrasing that is, rather than the bar lines, just as they have to sing it. The only way I know to make this work smoothly, rather than tangling you up in endless fiddling with 4 patterns and 3 patterns and 6 patterns, is to listen to the piece a lot until you've internalized its natural meter and then to conduct what you've internalized. This kind of thing is much easier actually for non-classically trained musicians who will tend to do this more easily anyway. You don't have to have internalized every detail before rehearsal one, of course. You can do it as you go along, rehearsal by rehearsal, as you teach it to the choir. In terms of actual conducting gestures, I find it's better just to gently show the minims passing by and lead the singers to do their own thing with the phrases, which is exactly what you've trained them to do anyway. That's better than trying to make sense of all the overlapping meters of all the parts. Keep your gestures subtle and gentle to match subtlety of the music, and you can do the rest with your eyes. Or, this is my last idea, you could actually perform it unconducted. Maybe except for key moments when the parts come together like starts and ends of phrases. After all, once you've helped your choir to really get inside this style of music for themselves, you might reasonably wonder what more you can really contribute by waving your arms around anyway. At some point, you realise that your job has just become being a focal point while they sing. I wouldn't recommend no-arm conducting for every piece of music by any means, but for this one, that's pretty much peak Byrd. I hope you found this deep dive into Byrd's Ave Verum useful. My name's Toby Wardman, and by the time you're watching this, I hope to have a little collection of these deep dives for conductors, each one focusing on a different piece of choral music. If you're listening right now to the podcast version, then you should know that there's a YouTube version which has snippets from the score on the screen, so it's not quite as puzzling to watch as it is to listen to. Search YouTube for Deep Dive Byrd or something like that. I guess conversely, if you're watching this on YouTube, you should know there's a podcast version where you don't have to stare at a screen. You can listen on your commute or whatever. Find it wherever you find your podcasts. If you like this video, then, well, please like it. If you have any comments, then comment. And if you want to see more, then subscribe. Anyway, I'm guessing you know already how to use YouTube. Enjoy Byrd. Bye.